So if you know with clarity what the ultimate goal for you two is, then what you do is you take a look at the tasks that are required to make that happen, and you divide and conquer based on your skills and attributes. Missy handles all the things that she's most suited to handle. I handle all the things that are most suited for me to handle. And it's like the sum of the part, that whole cliche that one plus one equals 17 at that point. You are able to get so much more accomplished when you divide and conquer and really are able to lean into the masculine and feminine at the highest levels, all pointed at the same goal. That's one of the most beautiful aspects of our existence, how we do that.
Yeah, and I would agree with you 100%. To welcome to the show, Jon and Missy Butcher. How you doing, Jon and Missy?
Good. Great. So good to be here, Alex.
Thank you, Alex, for having us.
Thank you so much for coming on the show. I've been a fan of your work and what you guys have been doing for the world for a while now. I was with Mind Valley for such a long time. I've had our mutual friend Vision on the show, and I was so impressed with Lifebook and what you guys kind of put together with Lifebook that I was like, I got to share this with my audience. I want to bring my audience is, because my wife and I both took the course a while ago, and it really did shape and change a lot of things in our life, in the way we look at things, perspective, and all this kind of stuff. So before we jump into your life philosophy, which is fascinating and oddly simple in the sense that everyone should be following these ideas, but not many people do. So we'll get into that as well. So can you guys tell me a little bit about yourselves before you started this amazing thing called Lifebook?
Sure. We're artists and entrepreneurs, basically. We're hopeless entrepreneurs, actually. We've started, I think we're at around 20 companies that we've started. Yeah. We've been together 33 years. Mm-hmm. So we've had a lot of time to do a lot of stuff. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And so we've had a lot of successes, a lot of epic failures, and a lot of in between. So really, it's been about art and entrepreneurship from a career perspective for us before Lifebook happened.
Yeah, because it happened to us.
Yeah.
Now, Jon, is it, if I remember correctly, you created Precious Moments?
My father's the artist, the actual visual artist of Precious Moments. And I'm chairman of the board of the companies. And so I sort of handled the business side. My dad handled this creative side. It's a full family business. But that didn't happen until I was in my 20s. That was my first real encounter with high level business. So that's where I cut my teeth on my core business competencies, which aren't much. They're very narrow, but they're very strong in the areas that they're strong in. Mm-hmm. But we started many, many businesses. Also, like we have a company called Purity Coffee that's the healthiest coffee in the world. Mm-hmm. Super happy with that company and excited about it. And a number of other really, really great companies that do good for the world. That's our criteria. Mm-hmm. It's got to be a win-win-win situation. Otherwise, we just don't have any passion for it.
Mm-hmm. Now, you said you had a lot of wins and failures. How do you overcome the failures? Because so many of us fail. And so many people are afraid of failing. I don't say I look forward to failing, but you learn when you fail. So how did you go over some of these epic fails that you're talking about?
Well,
I was just going to say Lifebook came out of one of the hardest times in our entire life.
True, true, true.
Not necessarily an epic fail, but I guess, kind of.
Yeah, and we'll talk about that a little bit later when we get to Lifebook. But but here is the philosophical premise that governs how we look at failure. What I really try to do is it doesn't matter what project I'm working on. It doesn't matter what company I'm working on. It doesn't matter what I'm doing. My own personal development is always the highest outcome. So it is always. So if I'm starting a business, we want to make money. Yes, we want to be successful. Yes, we want to be profitable. But the most important thing is what we're going to learn and how we're going to grow during that process. Always. That's the philosophical premise that we've really tried to install in our lives. And what that means is that failure is impossible. If your true outcome that you're after is your own personal development, you can't really fail. All you can do is
learn,
have an experience that didn't turn out the way that you thought it would, but it was an amazing learning experience, and hopefully you got some personal development. Mm-hmm. So to give you a concrete example of what that might look like, if a young person, and you know, Alex, that these days, totally unlike when I was, you know, in my early career, which you got a job with a company and you pretty much stayed for life till you got your gold watch, right? Right. Now it's 2 and 3. Now it's 2 and 3 years max, right?
Right.
So if a young person is looking at two possible career options, one of them might pay $5,000 more a year, while the other offers a much more extraordinary learning experience, where at the end of that 2 to 3 year stint, you will have developed a friggin' skill, a talent, versus the other one pays you more money, that's not the case. There is no question that I would choose the second one. Because if you continue to stack your personal development, whether you win or lose in each individual situation, if your own personal development and your learning and growth is the decision-making criteria, you literally can't fail. You've set up the rules of the game in a way that you can't fail. Yeah. So that's kind of how we look at that.
It's almost like those obstacles that come, or those hard things that come, they're there. They're gifts that the universe gives you because of what you intended or asked for. If you really are on a, you know, upward trajectory and trying to grow and become better, then you're always going to get gifts from the universe that help you hone your skills so that you can become better.
You learn so much more from your challenges than you do from your successes. Successes are great.
They're awesome.
Successes are great. And you learn from your successes too. You get your money, you get all those good things that you're after. But the failures are even more valuable. Mm-hmm. That's what really shapes you.
And you know, one thing that we've always done, Alex, is anytime we have an epic fail, which we've had a few, especially in business, is we literally, once we're over the pain of it and, you know, we can look at it objectively, we will literally make a list of all the learnings, everything we learned, good and bad, like we'll never do that again, or wow, this was amazing that came out of that.
Yeah.
And so we literally just get real conscious on it and keep that in our memory bank and learn from it.
That's where a lot of our rules for life come from. Mm-hmm. We're never doing that again.
Yeah. Because it didn't work, you know, or the timing wasn't right or whatever. Yeah.
So if you're persistent with that philosophy, at some point you're going to get to the point where you have learned so much. Mm-hmm. You've turned every single disappointment into an incredible growth experience. And you really know what you're good at, what you're not good at. It's a good way for us to live.
It's a process for sure.
Now, I have to ask you, because I mean, I've seen, I don't know, hundreds of hours of content by you guys at this point in the game after taking Lifebook and all the other things that I've seen of you two. What I find so fascinating about you two is the yin and yang of you two and how you guys balance each other so well. Being married now for a long time with my wife, I knew what a absolute savage I was before she showed up. Absolute hot mess.
Awesome.
It's in so many ways. And she had her things that I helped her with, but we really helped each other out. Can you talk a little bit about how both of you balance each other so well and how you guys deal with each? Because you guys are, for lack of a better word, a power couple in the sense that you are both like forces of nature in your own right. But when you joined forces, it seemed like it became this like supernova. And that's what a good relationship is. Is that a fair way
of it? Well, you know, I think that that's almost it, but not quite. It's not like we were super.
We were very young when we got together.
Yeah, right. Missy was 17 and I was 23. So it's not like we were super forces that came together and created something new. Missy created me. And you get it? And I created
her. I get it.
So the relationship is what created us as individuals. So how it works for us, Alex, is I'm a very masculine man. Mm-hmm. And so my job in this relationship is the structure, is the driving, is all those masculine qualities. Missy is a very feminine woman, and her job in this relationship is all the nurturing, healing stuff that I wouldn't have a chance to have in my life if it weren't for her.
Yep.
And she wouldn't have a chance to handle, right? And so what we're able to do as a very polarized couple, polarized in the most amazing spiritual sense, is... So everyone has masculine and feminine inside of them. Everyone does. masculine and feminine are the gender expression of the continuum. There's a continuum of masculine and feminine energies in all of us. Mm-hmm. There are some men that are very masculine, some men that are very feminine, some women that are very, right?
So, and everything so in between, that. Right?
And so as a single, if you want to really live the best life you can, you've got to have somewhat of a balance inside of yourself, because you can't go through life only masculine. Masculine goes off the rails without the feminine.
It'll destroy itself.
And you can't go through life only feminine, because feminine dissipates into nothing without the masculine structure. So as a single, your job is to create a balance in yourself that can help you navigate through life using masculine principles and feminine principles. But when you're a committed couple, a devoted couple like we are, that's all in, you can push those extremes so far out.
However you want, you know, whichever way it wants to go.
So I've had the benefit in my life. Well, first of all, I wouldn't even be here if it wasn't for Missy. I mean, I've got two brothers that are dead of drugs and alcohol, and everyone in my family, I'm the son of an alcoholic who's the son of an alcoholic, it's that way. I would be dead right now, no question, if it weren't for this relationship. I would have flown off the rails so long ago. Mm-hmm. But what we are able to do is I'm able to live in my masculine. And I'm talking about the divine masculine, not the toxic masculine, the masculine that protects, the masculine that builds, the masculine that structures and gets Creator. Things done. I'm able to live there and really hone those skills, because Missy's got me on the other side.
I get all that benefit of the masculine, the divine masculine, because he's here doing it for me.
And I've got the benefit of all the divine feminine, because here's a great example. Missy and I didn't go to school. We were like, screw school, we're not doing this. What we're going to do is we're going to travel the world with our kids, and they're going to learn that way. We're going to live in 12 different countries. We're going to go deep in those cultures, right? And so we went through about a 5 or 6 year period where we literally had to work with the public school to take our kids out for 6 months a year. If I would have been in charge of that project, there would have been literally a 0% chance that that could have gotten done. But Missy handles it like a boss, like the back of her.
Oh, yeah. Oh, I know. Oh, no.
Right. Yeah. You know, you're married.
I've been married for over 15 years at this point. Wow. And it, oh, I tell all young. Oh, I get it 110%. I mean, we build each other up. And when you're in a great, beautiful, committed relationship, you are balancing each other. And and by the way, sometimes it's not like, oh, you finished my sentences. Not that kind of relationship. No. We're very different.
Yeah.
Yes.
But the core vibration connects each other. And it's go ahead.
Sorry, I was going to say the key is to have a vision for what you want to create together, where you two know where you're going, right? And that's the whole Lifebook process.
And that's the base foundational vibration you're talking about.
So if you know with clarity what the ultimate goal for you two is, then what you do is you take a look at the tasks that are required to make that happen, and you divide and conquer based on your skills and attributes. Missy handles all the things that she's most suited to handle. Mm-hmm. I handle all the things that are most suited for me to handle. And it's like the sum of the part, that whole cliche that one plus one equals 17 at that point. Mm-hmm. You are able to get so much more accomplished when you divide and conquer and really are able to lean into the masculine and feminine at the highest levels, all pointed at the same goal. Mm-hmm. That's one of the most beautiful aspects of our existence. How we do that.
Yeah, I would agree with you 100%. I mean, it's hard. I always tell young men when they talk to me, I'm like, guys, find yourself, if you can, a partner that will balance you, man, because it will help you dramatically, dramatically. Mm-hmm. And I love that you said the divine masculine, because a lot of times that the word masculine is charged with other energies. But that's very true, because there is a very positive part of being masculine and there's a very positive part of being feminine, and combining the two is where you can really move forward in life. Now, before we get into Lifebook and the philosophies behind Lifebook, the thing I've noticed about Lifebook is you really systematically built a life, and everything that's important in life why do you believe that most people who spend God knows how many hours and days and years of their life doing just ridiculous things or dumb things or wasting time and don't sit down and try to plan where they're going in life, either individually or as a couple?
I think it's because the thought has never occurred to them. You don't see examples of that around you. It's not their fault for not doing it because they've never even conceived that it's possible to do that. That's why it's so important for those of us who are clued in to do our best to make ourselves the best people we can be and live the best lives we can so that people can see an example and have hope in their own life. That's why. It's so uncommon, Alex.
Oh,
for someone to really truly have stepped off the treadmill of their life for long enough to contemplate the kind of person they'd like to turn themselves into and the kind of life that they'd like to be living, and then to start moving in that direction with intention every day. That's so friggin' rare. And I will tell you this, in the world that's coming,
mm-hmm.
if you don't do that, you're fucked. Mm-hmm. See you in Meadowland. See you in right? I mean, you are done, because if you don't have a life vision that you're committed to achieving, if you're not in the driver's seat of your own life, there are so many powers, very powerful powers out there, that are going to be happy to step in and fill your vision gap and take you where they want to take you. And that's the ride most people are on, right?
So do you believe it is that programming that we're getting as we're growing up by either the media that's coming around us or just society, our family, you know, that they didn't know any better? All that information, like you said, there is not a lot of examples of people sitting up there and going, guys, think about what kind of life you want to live. They're just so busy in survival mode or doing what they've been told to do or told to, like, you got to go to college. Mm-hmm. You got to get a bachelor's degree. You got to get a master's degree to get a good job. And, you know, it's like, I can't.
You got it. You nailed it right there. Those are the things. It's survival mode or it's society's expectations, or it's mm-hmm. addictions, or it's mm-hmm. distractions. Our culture is set up to constantly feed you the things that are totally contrary to you sitting down and figuring out what you want at a deep soul level. Mm-hmm. That's where we are.
So let's get into Lifebook. What is the philosophy behind Lifebook?
The philosophy behind Lifebook.
It's becoming a conscious person and taking responsibility for yourself so that you can move from the passenger seat, being passive in your life, and getting in your own driver's seat. Just mm-hmm. like Jon was saying, if you don't become conscious of your own life and make your own decisions, meaning you're not at the wheel. You're over here lollygagging in the passenger seat, doing all the stuff you were saying.
Your boss, your parents, your teachers, your corporations, the news media. Right.
You don't have one. So it's
your direction is being controlled by tons of forces that are outside of you, and none of that's coming from inside.
It's living consciously and taking responsibility.
Our two core values at Lifebook are living consciously, meaning paying attention to what's going on in your life mm-hmm. and taking responsibility for yourself. Mm-hmm. Those are the two core tenets.
Starts with freedom, though. Freedom's number one. And then the two sides of that, well, actually, freedom and self-responsibility are two sides of one coin. If you're mm-hmm. truly going to be free, then you have to take full responsibility for yourself.
Now, we've been talking a lot about this thing called Lifebook. What is Lifebook? Because I know what it is. You know what it is. But the audience might not know exactly what it is. So can you explain to them what it is?
Yeah. Do you want me to just briefly explain to you how it came about? Because that kind of...
Yeah, the inspiration. Yeah, the inspiration let me do that. It would be awesome.
Okay, there was not really any inspiration behind it, Alex. Basically, what happened is about 30 years ago and change, I had basically a complete nervous breakdown. Mm-hmm. And I was running the workaholic program, sure. you know, the 12 to 16 hour days.
The cultural program.
President of
raised in.
Was mm-hmm. running five companies and burning the candle at both ends. We were partying like rock stars because we were young mm-hmm. and being crazy.
Plus we were making music. We were in the music industry. Yeah. So,
And what ended up happening when I was in my early 30s is that I ended up just collapsing under the weight of my own life. And I had what I now characterize as a complete nervous breakdown, which medically what it was it was a generalized anxiety disorder that caused by panic attacks. I didn't know what any of this stuff was, because back then anxiety was not a very deeply explored.
This was the mid 90s,
phenomenon, right?
Early,
this,
90s. Right.
Early
right.
90s, early
high
90s,
man.
So I had a series of debilitating panic attacks. I found myself in a generalized anxiety disorder that blossomed into full blown. The word is agoraphobia. Your house, you can't friggin' leave your house.
Right.
I couldn't get in the car to drive out of my driveway. Wow. Couldn't go to a grocery store. Couldn't go to a, without feeling like I was going to completely break apart through panic attacks. So I was in that state for 2 to 3 months. It couldn't fully shut down. I was CEO of 5 businesses at that time. I couldn't walk out of my yard, let alone even pretend to run my companies. So it shut down my entire life. Mm-hmm. I didn't know what to do. Didn't know where to turn. My self-image was completely destroyed. I was at absolute rock bottom. Mm-hmm. My dad was watching late night TV one night, and he was watching infomercials, and he bought me 2 personal development programs because he thought they might help. One was about anxiety. It was Lucinda Bassett's Attacking Anxiety. That was a game changer, because that's when I learned what was happening to me, what it was, and how, because it was so, and how to deal with it. So that gave me a little bit of a foothold. But the other one was Tony Robbins' Personal Power 2, the great selling course from the 80s, right? We all did that. Mm-hmm. And that was my first encounter with personal development, or the concept that you could consciously decide what kind of a person you wanted to turn yourself into, meaning what kind of character attributes you wanted to install in your own life. And you could decide what direction you wanted to take your life, where you wanted to end up, and start moving in that direction consciously with intention. I'm like, whoa, I've never heard that before. Didn't learn that in school.
Yeah, right.
Right.
And so I did that program, and I was like, wow, this is frigging crazy stuff. I felt better. Bottom line is, I started consuming personal development voraciously, and I started keeping the notes from those programs. And they were the greats, man. They were Deepak Chopra, Nightingale, Carnegie, Wayne Dyer,
yeah,
Brian Tracy. These were the masters.
Jim
right?
Ronan, yeah, all of them, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So I kept my notes in this little binder, and I'd bring this little binder with me everywhere I went. I had it with me. I was holding it with me for 10 years. And the reason is because if I was out somewhere and started to feel shaky, like, you know, panic attack city, I could open that binder up and read those words of wisdom. And I'd be like, okay, I got this. I'm going to be okay. It was like my lifeline. It was my life raft. And so over the years, using that tool, the next big thing that happened was I took my little binder and I realized, hey, there are categories of things in here.
You saw patterns.
I saw, yeah. So it's like, what categories of life do I need to master in order to have a get out of this hole, and then B, have a great life?
Fulfilling, full life, you know?
So that's when I identified, well, health and fitness can't be overlooked. I got to have my love relationship dialed in. I need to have my parenting strategies. I've got to have a career that creates financial abundance. That's when I identified the 12 categories of life that I had to master in order to live an extraordinary life that worked at a high level in every important area. Mm-hmm. And then from there, I figured out that in each one of those areas, I needed to ask and answer 4 questions that would totally get me in control of that area. The first one was, what are the beliefs about money, about love, about health, that are my behavior? Do some of them need to go? Are some of them antiquated and holding me back? The second question in each category was, what with clarity do I want in this area of my life? Mm-hmm. My vision. Okay. Third, what's the purpose behind that vision? Why is that important to me? Why do I want that? Why am I willing to do whatever it takes to achieve that? And then the last question was, okay, if that's my vision for health and fitness, if that's my vision for my career, if that's my vision for my love relationship, what are the strategies that are going to get me there? What do I need to do to move in that direction? So that's what a life book is. And it took 10 years for me to develop that. It's a book about 12 areas of your life where you define your beliefs, your vision, the purpose behind that vision, and what you need to do to manifest that vision in 12 areas of your life. Took me 10 years to write mine. Never showed it to anyone but Missy. No one ever saw inside that book.
We didn't think it'd be relevant.
No, I mean, it was just our tool for
right?
And yeah, right. Alex, it led us to our ideal life. In 2002, which was just about 10 years after I started that process, Missy and I had everything that we'd ever wanted in every category. Right. And that's when we realized that we could share this with other people and they could do the same thing we did. So what a life book is it's a 100-page book that you write for yourself that's a vivid description of the person that you want to be and the life that you want to live. Mm-hmm. What you've done, if you go through this process and create a life book, you've created an ideal self-image. You've created a crystal clear picture of your highest self. And then from there, you can start to move in that direction every day. Mm-hmm. That's what this tool is. Thank you.
Now, Missy, I want to ask you, just to go back a little bit, because I think this is important for people listening. When Jon was going through what he was going through, this kind of breakdown, as his partner, how did you deal with it yourself? And also, how did you help him along the way in the journey of this creation of this book?
Well, it was really, really hard because I couldn't really truly help him. This was internal. It was a complete internal meltdown. It was just, you know, I mean, really, it was an emotional crash.
It was.
And so for me, it was about, okay, I'm going to make the space around him safe. I got to hold space for this to heal. Mm-hmm. So I took care of everything that I could. He offloaded the businesses to his family and stuff like that, which was great. But for the home, I handled all that, our kids and everything. And I studied with him and I would look, I was always searching for new things to help this. And then I realized that at one point it was seriously a self-esteem issue that we had to go after. And so that's when we started working with Dr. Nathaniel Brandon. That was a game changer. That really shifted our lives.
He became our mentor for 20 years. Yeah. Do you know his work, Alex?
I do not.
He is widely regarded as the father of the concept of modern self-esteem. He wrote 20 books, The Art of Living Consciously, Honoring the Self, Pillars of Self-Esteem. He was a master of 20th century psychology.
And we were students of his. Like, we, ever since we got together, we'd read all of his books and all this. And so anyway, long story short is, I mean, I just did whatever the heck I could to help him and support him because I couldn't do it for him.
This is a perfect example, though, of what we were talking about earlier. What she did is she surrounded me with her feminine energy so that I could heal.
I could never
have even had a chance of making it through that without her. Never have it. She couldn't do anything directly inside of me,
but
she made everything outside of me the environment that would allow me to heal my inner world.
And then we did all the personal development together. And so I grew massively with him. It was incredible. Yeah.
It's so important that, you know, having that other partner that is supportive during these situations, because that could have easily been like, get off your ass. What's wrong with you? Yeah. All that kind of negative energy that you hear about, but that's what a good partnership is balance. When someone's weak, you get strong. When the other one gets strong, and it's a balancing of that yin and yang. Now usually
if the man's screwed, the exact thing he needs can come from the woman. And if the woman's screwed, same exact thing. What she probably needs has got to come from the other direction. That's the beautiful thing about the yin and yang, about the masculine and feminine. They go off the rails without each other, but together you've got everything you need for...
It's a motor. I mean, we talk about it being a, you know, like the yin and yang battery. Sign, it's a battery that goes round and around, you know?
Very much, very much. Now, you talk about these 12 categories. Can you tell everybody what those 12 categories are?
Sure. Yep. So 12 categories of life, and the first five are all you. The first five are internal, and they don't rely on anybody else. Some of the other ones, you got to have cooperation to make good, but these first five...
Got to start with yourself.
No excuses. Yeah. These first five, you don't need anyone's permission to get this right. The first is your health and fitness, foundation of your life in a lot of ways. The second is your intellectual life. As human beings, our minds are our tool of survival, incredibly important and overlooked in our society in a lot of ways. The third category is your emotional life. And that's where I got destroyed.
That controls everything.
That's where I got destroyed. Having a healthy emotional life is one of the most important aspects of reaching your true potential.
It's true.
The fourth category is your character. Who are you really deep down? What are the attributes that you want to build into your life? And the fifth category is your spiritual life. which is your relationship with God, the universe, and everything that exists, whatever your particular version of that. So the first five, health and fitness, intellectual, emotional, character, and spiritual, those are all you separate from the rest of the world. You need no one's permission to work on those areas. No one else can stop you. Those are all yours.
If you're enjoying this conversation, I invite you to go deeper down the rabbit hole with me on Next Level Soul TV. It's packed with exclusive content like live special guest Q&As, daily podcasts, commercial-free access to the entire Next Level Soul catalog, early access to episodes before they air, and special meditations you won't find anywhere else. We will be adding new exclusive content every month. Plus, you can connect with me during my monthly live streams. Just go to nextlevelsoul.com/subscribe and join our soulful community today. I'll see you on the inside.
Now, from there, we look at relationships. And there are three kinds of relationships in your life. The first is romantic love. So love relationship, which is the foundation of our life. Our love relationship is the foundation of everything we have. Our families, our businesses, everything. Mm-hmm. The second category is parenting. Your relationship with your children. And the whole human race depends on at least some of us doing that job well. You know?
Isn't that ain't that the truth?
And then the third relationship category is your social life, which I'll tell you, that one's a sleeper. That category is, we overlooked that category for a lot of years, but when we really understood the power of having the right people around you versus the wrong people around you, we realized this isn't one of the weakest categories. This is one of the most powerful categories, right? And then from there, we go into your business life. And there are two categories there, your career and your financial life, which are both very intimately tied together, but they have to be looked at separately because you can have a phenomenal career and a totally jacked up financial life. Mike Tyson made $350 million and he declared bankrupt. That's an incredible career and a jacked up financial life. And we've also seen the opposite in other rare occasions, someone with a very modest career that's handled their financial life so well that you know. So those two things have got to be thought about separately, even though they're very well connected. And then the 11th category is called your quality of life. And that category has to do with the things that you want, the environments that you want to be surrounded by, and the experiences that you want to have in your life. That's the fun stuff.
Like, what does it all add up to? How do you really live your life? Do you have a daily high quality of life daily? How does it all?
And then the last category, the fundamental mission of Lifebook is to take a look at those 11 categories, define with clarity your ideal self in each of them. What is your ideal level of health and fitness? What does your ideal love relationship look like? What would your ideal career be, right? So you create basically 11 subvisions in each of these 11 categories. And then the 12th category is called your life vision. And what you do there is you take those 11 category visions and you roll them all up into what your ideal life, your highest self could look like. And then, Alex, you got a North Star. Then you got something that you can sink your teeth in, roll up your sleeves, and move in that direction every day. Mm-hmm. Having that is an absolute game changer. I will not be able to put into words in this podcast how important it is and how much it changes your life if you have that and start running your life according to it. It's a different way to experience life on the planet Earth.
True. It changes your daily choices. Yep. Once you have that vision, your days all of a sudden become very clear to what you're going to do that day.
Well, you know where you're going. It's a decision-making framework. Yeah. Every single decision, every choice you have, you ask the same question. Does this choice get me closer to that or farther away? If it gets me closer, I'm all in. If it gets me farther away, it's a hell no.
But most people don't even know what that North Star is because no one's ever sat down thinking about what this is. We just run around aimlessly like chickens without heads around as a general statement. Then be like, I feel lost. I feel lost. I hear that all the time. I feel lost. I have no direction in life because you haven't sat down and thought about it. Seriously broke it down and thought about it. One thing you said, Jon, that was really interesting. And it's something that's so important. I want to kind of really focus in on it is when you started to break, when you originally started to do this for yourself, you started to identify the beliefs you had around each category. And that's what people don't understand, that they have these subconscious beliefs about money. Like, you have to work hard for money, or if I'm rich, I must be bad because only bad people are rich. And these kind of beliefs in their head, or I can never really find love because I'm not lovable, or no one really will love me. These beliefs, can you give any advice on how to kind of start to first identify kind of the cancer of these negative beliefs, and then how to get in there and literally extract it from your life so you can move forward?
Okay, so let me give an example of how a disempowering belief can derail your life, and then what you can do with it. It doesn't matter what your vision is in the category. My vision for my financial life is I want to double my income this year. But if I have a belief that was installed in me since childhood that the love of money is the root of all evil, I will figure out how to sabotage my vision, because I don't want to be evil. And if I'm going to double my income, that, right? And so that's a contradiction. And that's one of the things that Lifebook does, is it brings those contradictions to the surface. Mm-hmm. I want an extraordinary love relationship, but all the love relationships that I've seen in my life are jacked up. And truly, at the end of the day, I believe that all women cheat and all women leave. Or I believe that men can't be trusted. You got a belief like that, you're gonna jack up your vision, right? So during the Lifebook process, deep into what are the beliefs that have controlled your behavior up to this point. If you discover disempowering beliefs, which you will, sometimes, Alex, just the consciousness will do the job right there. Holy shit. I really, truly want to be wealthy, but I just realized that I've been carrying this with me since I was 5 years old, because I learned it in Sunday school. And you know what? It's irrational. It doesn't make sense. I'm going to drop that one. And sometimes that's good enough, like literally just bringing consciousness to it. Other times, you've got to coax that belief down the stairs. Sometimes you might even have to have therapy to let it go.
Dig it out.
But the bottom line is, you've got to extract it. And what the Lifebook process does, Miss, why don't you talk about this? Because you say this beautifully. It's about how the Lifebook process aligns you and brings those beliefs and that dissonance so that you can get harmonious and vibrating. Yeah.
So basically, we dissect your life. Your life is made up of 12 categories that we've identified as the most important ones to have an extraordinary life, right? But really, it's just one life. So during the Lifebook program, we go in there and we dissect each one, and we say, okay, what are your beliefs here? What are your beliefs here in this category? And at the end of that, what you'll find is that this belief was contradicting, canceling out this belief. Yeah. So I'm not getting anywhere in either one of those categories. So basically what it does is it gives you this congruence and integrity.
Alignment.
It's alignment and integrity, because what you've done is you've fought down with your powerful consciousness. We have amazing power with our consciousness. It's like Cyclops with his red eyes. It's like, if you focus on something, it's going to be huge. Yeah. It's going to be big. So anyway, once you do that, then you have this entire flow. You're no longer fighting within your beliefs. You know what all of your beliefs are. In all these 12 categories,
they're harmonious
and they're integrated. And then you're back to your one life, and it's all flowing. It's flowing toward that life vision, as opposed to there's bumps everywhere.
Internal friction.
And also it's dissonance.
I had nothing but internal friction and dissonance when I was going through my situation.
Turmoil.
I had years long process of getting rid of the contradictions so that I could experience alignment. And then once that happens, Alex, once you get alignment with your philosophical beliefs, with your vision for each category, where there's no war inside, once you get that alignment and you're moving in the direction of your life vision, you notice when dissonance come into your life. Notice when a relationship comes in that's causing friction.
It's obvious.
Everything was friggin' flowing in harmony yesterday. I was completely aligned. And today, I've been knocked off track, and it's because of this thing, and that's not acceptable. I'm going
to
handle
it. Or you have to, you know, adapt in some way or make some sort of an adjustment.
The most valuable thing that you could ever have is an aligned life vision with the contradictions that you're moving toward with flow. And if things come out of left field that are going to sideswipe you, you notice, and it's not acceptable. got to get back into that flow.
Exactly. You know what it really is? It Lifebook helps you do the inner work. You know, everybody talks about spiritually the inner work. Well, what is that inner work? What are you really trying to do? You're trying to get unencumbered. You're trying to get rid of all the bullshit distractions, everybody else's opinions out, you know, so you can hear your soul song. So you can hear what you are supposed to be doing here. And then you ask yourself these questions once you get all that noise out, and then you're off to the races. It really is a tool to help you do that inner work through these Socratic questions that we ask you.
Sure.
Yeah. Right.
Now, do you guys believe that you attract these? If you have a negative bias towards like men can't be trusted, you're going to probably be attracted to men that can't be trusted.
That's what you're looking for.
On a subconscious level, subconscious level.
Yeah. Anytime you think about either I don't want that or I do want that, you're letting the universe is neutral. If you're saying, I don't like that, ooh, I don't like that, I don't like that, it doesn't matter. It's going to come to you because that's the vibration you're putting out. Like literally, it doesn't matter. The universe can't hear the don't. It doesn't hear, I don't like that.
I got a good Buddha quote for this.
It's the continuous repetition.
Buddha said, all we are is what we have thought. What we think, we become.
There you go.
So if you're going to be going around thinking about what you don't want all day long, you are thinking about what you're going to become.
And once you really get that and realize, you're like, holy, this is a huge responsibility to get my freaking mind under control, you know?
It's such an incredibly powerful tool that people misuse all the time. Let's not even talk about self-talk. Yeah. I mean, the negative self-talk that you beat yourself up and all of this kind of stuff. But the beliefs are such a powerful, because if you can start extracting those from your life and at least identifying them and working on them, you can move forward. But if you, like I had a negative bias in my head for years I didn't want to direct a major motion picture because I almost made a $20 million movie with the mafia. And all of that trauma and abuse that I went through during that time, subconsciously, I just kept constantly beating myself up along the way about it. Yeah. So finally I said, wait a minute, I got to break. And the second I broke through, I was like, oh, and now I could just do it. But it took forever so those negative beliefs could screw 20 years of your life, if not your entire life.
Yeah, your entire life. Those
negative beliefs can ruin incredibly important areas of your life, like your relationships and your financial life, like big stuff. It's really important to understand the philosophical premises that are controlling your behavior and make sure that they're empowering instead of disempowering, because make no mistake about it, we choose our beliefs. You have different beliefs now than you had 10 years ago, and you will have different beliefs 10 years from now. As we go through life, we adopt beliefs based on our experience. It is a full choice. What I do, I don't really believe in belief in the sense that there aren't things that I believe out there. I either know or I don't. I got this from Sadhguru. Know or I don't know. Mm-hmm. How I use my beliefs is I take a look at what I want in my life, and I ask myself, what would be the most empowering thing that I could believe that would move me most effectively toward this goal? So I know what I want from my physiology. The belief that I've installed is I will be a strong muscular athlete for the rest of my life. I believe that. That is a belief that I consciously decided to put in my head, and beliefs control behaviors. And so that's exactly that's the path I'm on, and that's the path I'm going to stay on.
It's like you're
programming
yourself.
My beliefs as tools to get what I want.
That's right.
You're reprogramming yourself, because you were programmed. Right. If you can be programmed negatively, you can be programmed positively.
And so much of this that we're talking about is just unconsciousness.
Yes.
It's just people being completely unconscious because they're in the quagmire of the overwhelm of our society and the all that mess, right? Until you come to a point where you're like, I am sick of this, or whatever it is for you. Whenever you come to that point where you're like ready for a change, then enter Lifebook, and literally you can really organize. You can get into that quagmire and clean it all out and clean it all up. Get to your higher self, listen to yourself, and plan your life.
And within 45 days, you're going to be living a completely different life. And that's not an exaggeration.
Mm-hmm. And that's why I find meditation so important, because it completely silences this noise. Yeah. It gives you a moment for yourself so you can actually think, accept new ideas, accept things, and just go, wait a minute. And that's the thing. It's pausing where you are in life, this insanity. We've all been there. Mm-hmm. We've all been in this insanity, and this world is very intoxicating, extremely intoxicating. But when you pull back and start to look at the wider image, like you guys did with analyzing these wonderful questions and creating these categories, you start thinking, well, wait a minute. And you start moving to a direction. Now, you've had so many people go through Lifebook. What are some success stories that were just remarkable that you would love to share?
Oh my gosh, you've had so many.
Oh, man, we've had 100,000 people go through Lifebook. And one of the things about Lifebook is we've spent a lot of time on the science of personal development. And I think we're the only personal development company that has quantified personal development so we can track and measure it over time. So we've got 113 data point assessment that scores you across the 12 categories. And it gives you an overall quality of life score called your life quotient. It's almost like your quality of life IQ, right? So, and we've got 7 levels that people fall into on this continuum. The lowest level is called the critical level. And that's where if your life quotient is under 60, you're in pain in every area of your life to the point where it's dangerous. Like, it's dangerous.
You're really suffering.
Right. It goes from critical to compromise all the way up a continuum to extraordinary on the top. Over 120 score on our life quotient. You're firing on all cylinders. Like, literally every single category of your life is going really well. Mm-hmm. And there's 5 levels in between. Mm-hmm. So we've seen people, Alex, go from scores in the 60s, mm-hmm. pain in every single area of their life, not knowing where to turn, to scores in the 120s in 18 months. Mm-hmm. Now, 18 months is a long time. That's a year and a half. But that person is living a completely different life on this planet. That is a different life. Mm-hmm. You've mm-hmm. gone from pain in every area of your life to excellence in every area of your life. Mm-hmm. So we've seen that, and we've seen massive transformations. And if you want to see the Lifebook stories, jump on the Mind Valley website.
We've got thousands
of deep, beautiful success stories.
We can't. I can't watch them without just bawling. Because I mean, seriously, some people will just say it. I saved my life because of this program.
Well, it saved my life.
Yeah. I mean, it's just beautiful. It's really beautiful.
Yeah. We're mm-hmm. we're privileged and honored to do this work.
We really are. It's very true.
So let me ask you, what are some of the major obstacles that you find people have when trying to implement these ideas that we're talking about here?
Well, what do you mean implement the ideas?
So just the idea of going through the program, or even just taking the basic ideas of this conversation that we, mm-hmm. if you just took, hey, these are the 12 categories, ask these 5 questions without even using your program, just taking those ideas, mm-hmm. what stops people or these obstacles that they have to overcome to even begin to believe that this is a possibility in their life?
Well, that's overwhelm, man. I mean, it took me 10 years to do what you can now do in 6 weeks at the highest possible level. Mm-hmm. And this is important, because if you wanted to try to do this yourself, it would be as hard for you as it was for me. Probably harder, because I at least had some resources and I had nothing but time because I couldn't do anything else. But it took me years, right? But now with the Lifebook system, all you have to do is a step-by-step process. Mm-hmm. And if you just, because it's completely overwhelming to try to get a grip on your entire life and figure out, right? It's overwhelming.
Of course.
But the system that we've created allows you to do it step by step. There's basically 45 exercises. All you've got to do is the one in front of you, and you just keep going methodically through the system. And by the end of that process, you will not believe what you've created. You will have written a 120-page book that contains a vivid description of your ideal self and your ideal future. Right. And it's no joke. It came out of you, nobody else. It came out of you.
But you know what? I think one of the biggest hurdles is that, like, especially if, like, I'll just take an example of being, if I'm a mom, I'm overwhelmed. I have a career. I have 3 kids. My husband's working all the time. complete overwhelm. And I'm just literally doing this to stay above water.
Yeah.
Just like to keep my life going. I can't do anything. One thing out of the, I'm dead, right? So when you talk to that person and say, this can make that all organized and flow. And they think, what are you even talking about? I can't take 6 weeks. Yeah. I can't take 1 minute. I can't, you know what I mean? This whole thing is going to fall down. Well, guess what? This whole thing is going to fall down anyway. At some point, that's not going to work. It doesn't, you can't do that. You can't just barely paddle. I mean, I guess you can and stay there in, you know, stasis in this non-moving, non, but it's just this, again, it's this cesspool of just everything overwhelm and you're lost and I'm so lost, you know, we hear that all the time. But what happens seems counterintuitive, but it's actually, you need to stop doing that. It happened to us. Life just stopped in a minute. It's like, boom, you're not doing that anymore. You're doing this. So we didn't have a choice. So I get that this is hard to say, okay, I'm going to stop doing this that holds my life, my whole life together just a minute and take it off and do this and get really think down my whole life, get conscious of everything and then go back here and refix this life. And that's what people do. And when they do that, they go from a 60 in the life quotient up to 120 because they freaking did the work. It's all about internal work. It starts with the internal alchemy.
It's pay now or pay later. Yeah. That's the bottom line. Pay now or pay later. Either you can pay now by bringing a little bit of consciousness to your life and taking a little bit of time to figure out where you want to take your life, or you can pay later with regrets that you didn't do that, with a train wreck of a life, which is what usually happens with people that are living unconsciously.
Mm-hmm. Can you explain the importance? Because Missy, you said something really important there that you, that, and a lot of my listeners are, I'm sure I was as well. And I do sometimes in life where you feel like you just, I can't breathe. And I have to say specifically from the female side, because I've seen it with my mother when she was raising me. I seen it with my wife. When we have twins, like all the, you get overwhelmed, and men do as well, but you get overwhelmed and you feel like if I stop, the whole world is going to come crashing down. But the thing that most people don't understand is if you don't stop, you are actually doing more of a favor to your family, to your community, if you take care of yourself. And that's on all the categories. Can you kind of dive into that a little bit?
Yeah. Well, if you, the bottom line is, especially for a woman, because if you're in your feminine, you're a nurturer and you give continuously, you're a continuous well of giving, right? So if you are malnourished or if you're starved, then the whole thing does fall down. The whole entire ecosystem that you're trying to build in your home or wherever.
Can't give away what you don't have.
All done. Right. Can't give away what you don't have. So self-care is number one. And when we talk to couples, especially entrepreneur couples, maybe the wife is at home, maybe she's helping in the business, she's raising the family, doing that, you know, it's self-care. And it really is to both, to any human being, they should care for themselves first. That's salt baths. That's a little bit of meditation in the morning, you know, before the kids wake up and they take your life on a ride. And so, yeah, there's nothing more important than self-care. And that's what this whole thing is about. That's what Lifebook is all about. The whole thing came from Jon not taking care of himself, you know, from an internal position, from coming in, going out. And so that's really what it is. You have to, that's the only way change happens. The only way change happens is in here. And then it goes outward in concentric circles.
You've got to care enough about yourself and your family to give yourself the gift of a few days to step off the treadmill so you can plan the rest of your life. And you know what I mean?
People spend
more time planning a trip to Disneyland than they do contemplating where they'd like to take their life. And it's so important, especially if you have kids.
Yeah.
Especially if you have kids.
That's right.
Another aspect that I think is really important, Alex, is the aspect of a couple going through Lifebook. It's so powerful for a couple to do it because 90% of the problems that a couple are going to have will be disagreements, not being on the same page in one or more of these areas.
Oh, yeah.
She's a spender and he's a saver.
Yeah. Right, exactly. Or love languages are different. Right?
And so Lifebook is a way for a couple to get on the same page in every area of life. And that the importance of that just simply cannot be overstated. That's where 90% of your friction comes from. Missy and I never fight about anything important because that shit is off. We get pissy with each other sometimes and that those little things. But I'm talking about the big issues. They don't exist in our lives because we've taken the time to figure out where we're going in all of these important areas. We've got complete agreement. We divide and conquer. And if we're going to have friction, it's going to be over small, stupid stuff, not about anything big and important.
That's true.
We've eliminated.
And I'll tell you, even that stuff is the bickering or even just petty bullshit.
Goes away.
Because once you have a life vision, a shared love relationship vision, let's just take your love relationship vision.
That ain't part of it.
Yeah. You've decided this is where you're going. Where's the bickering and the petty bullshit?
That's not in my life book. Let's not do that.
So let's not do that. All right.
In a perfect world, yes, that's it. But you've been married a long time and I've been married for a decent amount of time. So
process. It's a process.
It is a process. No question. But you know what? What's really interesting about that, and you're absolutely right, is when a couple goes through this program, when they define these categories in their lives, you always see these fights like it's never about the dish. If they get into a huge brawl, like, you didn't take out the garbage. It's not about the garbage. It was never about the garbage.
Pulling out everything.
It's about this or that thing. It just builds up and builds up. It's so funny. But when you finally get all that cleared out of the way, then it might just be about the dish.
That's the goal.
It truly, hopefully, it's just about the dish. And you just go, you know what? You're right. I should clean up after myself. Or I should do this. Or maybe I'll pick up my underwear off the floor. Hopefully at this stage, we've already cleared that. That's old bad. That's like first few years in the relationship conversations. Right. Now, what do you guys want to see for individuals who go through? What is your hope for individuals who go through this program?
Oh, it's super simple. We want to see individuals move from the passenger seat of their lives to the driver's seat of their lives.
Co-create.
We want to see individuals flip the switch. And this is what it is. It's a binary thing that happens. It's a switch that gets flipped somewhere during the course of the program. And you never know what category it's going to come, but it's where
it's an on flip. It's an on switch.
It's an on switch where you all of a sudden realize at the deepest possible level for the first time in your life, my life is mine. I own it. There's going to be no knight in shining armor coming to my rescue. No one's coming to make my life right. If I have a desire for a happy, successful, fulfilling, balanced life, it is up to me to figure out how to satisfy that desire. And that's when you become the decision maker at the center of your own existence and start to direct your life consciously. You are now the CEO in your own life. You're the boss of your own life. You're going to create an amazing vision for the person that you're going to turn yourself into and the life you're going to live. You're going to commit to that vision and you're going to move in that direction with intention every single day of your life. That's what we're after. And then this program generates humans like that. And we want a community of humans like that.
That's right.
And that looks different for everyone.
That's what I was going
to
say.
It looks different for every single person.
And that's the next level. That's how we change the world. That's how we get real diversity back. Like real individual, just mountain movers, changers, people that are in control. It's literally going from being half dead, asleep, mediocre, to boom, you're on, you're electrified, you're passionate, your life is so exciting instead of, oh, it's so drudgery. It's literally dark and light. It's from darkness to light. That's what we're going for.
And Ellis, I want to share the most important thing that we've learned in the last 30 years that really ties beautifully into this. And this is why no one else can do this work for you. This is why your answer will never come from a book or from a guru or from a personal development seminar that you go to and learn somebody else's wisdom. It's because, and we learned this through looking at tens of thousands of assessments and thousands of life visions and working with thousands of people, there is no one right answer for everyone in any area of human endeavor. There is no one right strategy that will work for everyone on the planet. There's no one right diet. There's no one right religion. There is no one right thing for everybody. And once you realize that, you see what is the biggest problem in the world right now, which is the notion that my way is the right way. And if you're not down with my program, there's going to be trouble. If that one thing could go away in the world right now, we'd be living in the golden age. So when you realize that there is no one thing that will work for everyone, you can stop being so self-righteous and get off of your little high horse and allow other people to live the way they want to live, and you live the way you want to live. You don't put your shit on other people, and you do not allow other people to put their shit on you. That's the world that we want to see. So we're trying to make a contribution.
That's beautiful, my friend. Now, I want to ask both of you to address your category. Missy, I want you to talk to women who are watching right now and say, I can't, I don't have the time. This doesn't make sense to me. I want you to give that kind of like a little message to them. And Jon, I want you to talk to the guys listening and going, this is woo-woo crap. This is, you know, I'm a dude. I'm a give the testosterone. Talk to each. So each of you, just take a moment.
Please talk to them directly. Gives a message to women. Yes. Her best advice to women.
And like, yours to men. Yeah.
You go first. Yeah.
Well, I was hoping that she could do the soft one.
So, well, I mean, this is what I tell my kids. This is what I tell my kids. No one knows you better than you. Not even me. So you need to trust your own gut, heart, and mind. That's your intuition. Your gut, heart, and mind. Listen, check in with that first. You know what's best. Be yourself and stay true to that. Because if you do that, it's like everything comes from that. That's beautiful. If you really mm-hmm. are truly like, you're doing your best to stay true to yourself and stay pure and stay good and kind and unconditionally loving, then you permeate that out. I mean, that's, you do nothing but become a lighthouse for other people. And to me, that's like being a good example is kind of like, that's a thing that you're supposed to do. That's what I was taught, right, as a kid. So I think it's just be true to who you really are. Be that and go do that and don't let anybody stop you.
One of the most important things about that being a good example is that one of the reasons that people don't even know that a life vision is possible or how critical it is, because they don't have any examples out there of people living this way, of people who know who they are, who know where they're going. They've got an extraordinary life in every area because they brought consciousness to it and they've done work on themselves, right? We don't have examples like that. And that's one of the big benefits of going through this and building a life like that, so that people can see examples. Mm-hmm. Right? That people need hope.
Yeah.
They don't know where to turn.
And the more we have, the more different Lifebook people we have, the more diversity we have, the more people can relate to someone, because we're all so different. You know what I mean? When Jon and I first started out, there was one Lifebook, and we're who we are, but everybody's so different. Now we've got thousands of people in Lifebook living this way, and they're all different. And that's spreading like wildfire, because someone that can't resonate with me and Jon will resonate with that person or that person or see this person. And then it's like, oh, it awakens them. That's really what's going on here, Alex, is we're awakening people to the fact that their life is going their way, either on autopilot or not. Yeah. So get off of autopilot, get a hold of your wheel, get this car back on the road.
And that would be my message to men is, and it would be a little bit more manly. it's like, bro, if you don't have a clue of the person that you want to turn yourself into and the life that you want to build, what the hell are you doing every day? What are you doing? You're waking up and you're putting on your clothes and you're going to a job that you don't like. And because you don't have your own life vision, you spend your time and energy building your boss's life vision. And right, what are you doing? You've got to get in the driver's seat of your own life. No one's going to do that for you. No one's going to solve this problem for you.
And we need you. We need everyone.
You have more potential inside of you than you could ever cultivate in a lifetime. In order to brush up against that potential, you've got to take a little bit of time and contemplate who you want to turn yourself into and what direction you want to take your life, and then commit to that. Because you could be great. You really could be great. Don't choose mediocrity just because you're lazy or just, and here's the other thing, man, it's not your fault, because no one's ever told you this before. No one's ever told you that you could actually create a vision for yourself and direct your life consciously, but I just did. Now you know, now you got no excuse.
That's right.
So you got to put on your big boy pants starting tomorrow and turn yourself into what you are meant to become.
I love it.
There was a slight difference in energy, but I like both messages.
Did you catch that?
Did you catch the subtle? It was subtle. It was not. It's a subtle energy shift.
That's the masculine and feminine 1-2 punch right there.
Right. I mean, it was so beautifully done. And she's like, she's so soft. And she's like, da, 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 da. And you're like, dude. And like, it was beautiful.
Yeah.
Now, guys, I'm going to ask you a few questions I ask all of my guests.
Okay.
What is your definition of living a fulfilled life?
Fulfillment means to be filled up. That's what it means. Mm. Fulfillment is when everything's in its proper place. Mm. Fulfillment is when you can take a look at your entire life and you just feel so full of love and it's full. That's what the word means. It's full of love and full of joy and full of happiness, full of abundance. So fulfillment entails having crossed a threshold where the lion's share of the work has been done and you've got an almost automatic quality to your life. Here's a couple of concrete examples. I'm not working really, really hard to get in shape anymore. In shape. I've done that work. I've done the study. I know what to eat. I know how to exercise. And now I'm maintaining in a relaxed, enjoyable way. I'm not working like a dog to make money. I've crossed that threshold. I've got abundance in that area of my life. It entails having reached simplicity on the far side of complexity, where you've worked through the complexity of your life and you've arrived in a place where you're filled up every day without an immense energy drain pushing that boulder up the hill. You've arrived. Everything is there and everything is good.
Wow. That was like, ooh, beautiful. I have like two words. That was like gorgeous. Well, to me, it's like once fulfillment is like Jon said, you've arrived, you're there. You've healed all the hurts, all the things inside yourself. You've emptied it all out. You've cleaned out the cobwebs. And it's peace. Mm-hmm. You're centered and kind of truthfully, kind of empty, open. Right.
And at the same time, completely full.
Completely full because right? Everything's in its place. Right. So now you are this well of the way I try to look at myself this way. This is what I do every morning. I have a ritual that I do this. I'm a well now of nonstop feminine energy. So I am available and of service to everyone and everything in my day and as I attack. So that's to me fulfillment.
I think the reason that we're able to answer that question is because that's the life that we're living right now. We have arrived. Right. There's no more longed for vision out there in the future. It's on top of us, Alex. We've worked so hard on this. We're in it. We wake up in it every single day and there's nothing that feels better than that, man.
Now, if both of you can go back in time and talk to Little Missy and Little Jon, what advice would you give them?
Oh, man.
I don't know, man. Probably what I tell my kids, just stick true to you, you know, stick true to you. Don't let anybody take you off course. If you really know, no in your heart, don't ever let anybody take you off course. It's your head, your heart, and your gut. Those are your three intuition pieces.
I like that. My childhood was so jacked up that it's hard for me to even know what I would say that's to my little self to try to help navigate the shit that I went through. I think that it for me, it would have been more along the lines of there was an amazing speech that Winston Churchill gave to, I think it was some military academy. He was doing the commencement announcement. Yeah. He got up on that stage and he went up to the microphone and here was his speech verbatim. Never, 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 never give up. And then he walked away.
Wow. Brilliant. Drop the mic.
That's probably what I stay alive long enough to get your shit together and then you're going to have a good life. That would have been my advice.
That's good. I love it.
Perfect. Now, how do you guys define God, source energy, the universe in your lives?
In a word, consciousness. And kind of it's everything. Everything that is part of God, the universe. It's the quantum soup, the quantum whatever. That's how I see.
We're just now, just in the last few years, as we're transitioning Alex from Lifebook allowed us to master the 3D physical world. That's the bottom line. We mastered the areas of living as a human being on this planet. And then once we did that, this was about 4 or 5 years.
Was it? Almost 10. Anyway,
we started to transition into, you know, we've got this handled. Now we can start to explore this question that you just raised. Mm-hmm. And so we're infants. We're infants in this area, but it's really exciting. It's mysterious. It's sexy. It's sensual. Mm-hmm. We're really having a good time with it. Mm-hmm. I see the answer to your question, God, source energy, all that. I see it as very mechanical. And to me, it's energetic vibration. Everything in the universe is made up of energetic vibration. That's a literal statement. And what is so crazy, man, is that thought is energetic vibration. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. thought is the same stuff as a rock or a skyscraper, right? So that's where it gets really, really interesting.
Well, thought is manifest.
Thought is creative, yeah. and mm-hmm. thought is causative. Mm-hmm. So yes, you can use it to manifest. And this is the area that I think that we're going to go deep into exploring. Mm-hmm. We've got a couple things that we've got to do yet to button up Lifebook, completely finish Lifebook, one of which is to apply AI to it, which is happening right now. But by the end of this year, our work with Lifebook is going to be done, meaning the system's going to be complete and buttoned up. After that happens, I think that this is going to be our area of exploration. There are a number of doorways into what can be characterized mm-hmm. as the spiritual world or the world mm-hmm. of energy. There's religion, there's meditation, there's sex magic, there's plant medicines, there's so many different, there's many different doorways in, right?
Just nature.
And so we're really looking forward to exploring that in the future. That's our next big thing. Mm-hmm.
And what is the ultimate purpose of life?
Well, Kafka said the purpose of life is to live it. So that's a good one.
I think it's to really find yourself and bring that out. I mean, I think that this is totally me though. It's like, okay, there's some magic inside of me. There's gifts inside of me that is a piece of this tapestry that we're all living in. It's my job to bring that out in my everyday living through with my kids, my husband, my life, to really live my values and my beliefs and my spirit here, like bring mm-hmm. that. It's kind of like bringing heaven to earth, yeah, you know,
that's great.
It's bringing heaven to earth.
I will say that I don't believe in a general purpose to life for the human race any more than I believe in any one right strategy. Yeah. I think this is personal for everybody.
That's
right.
True.
So, but I will tell you what my purpose in life is. My purpose in life is to forge myself and the world around me in the image of my values.
Mm-hmm.
That's I want to create myself because we are both the sculptor and the sculpted, mm-hmm. right? I want to create myself, and to the extent that I can, I want to create the world around me in the image of the things that I value most.
Beautiful,
right? So that's mm-hmm. life is about finding yourself, but life is also about creating yourself. That's the intention and allowing aspect of life.
And so, ultimately, I'll add one more because that was beautiful. To mine, it's that to be self-actualized, to really fully be fulfilled, right, and at peace, then comes service to others. Mm-hmm. And to me, that's like the holy, holy grail. If you really can be pure, clear, whatever, at least enough to help other people, you know what I mean? To be of service to others, that gets me off. So.
Now, where can people find out more about Lifebook and the amazing work that you're doing in the world, guys?
All you got to do is Google search Lifebook. That's all you got to do. Mind Valley is our partner. Mm-hmm. So mm-hmm. Mind Valley is our major distribution partner. Mm-hmm. So you can go on Mind Valley's website, and mindvalley.com/Lifebook is our official link. Mm-hmm. But you can just Google search Lifebook and see so much stuff there. Mm-hmm.
And I will put a link in the show notes.
All right,
everybody.
Great. That's man, it's been great spending time with you. This has been.
Thank you, bro.
Okay, yeah, go ahead. Sorry.
One last question. Okay.
Go ahead.
Do you have a parting message for the audience?
Oh, parting message. Do you have one? Mr. Wise Man.
Well, I'll tell you what, I've really enjoyed this interview with you. I mm-hmm. like
Thank
your
you.
Energy a lot. And I think
Thank
we had, no, I mean, my parting message is just, if you don't feel if you don't feel in control of your life right now, if you want a deeper understanding of yourself, if you want to have the ability to shape yourself in exactly the way you want, you can take control of your life. Even though you don't see that, it's not very common, but it is possible. Jump online, just take a look at some of the videos and see if this resonates with you. And if it does resonate with you, this system, which saved my life and has improved the lives of hundreds of thousands of people, it really, really works. It will, and by work, I mean, it will allow you to create measurable results. It will allow you to define a vision for your life that you can hang your hat on and then start to move toward that vision.
That's beautiful.
Wonderful thing to do to bring this kind of consciousness to your existence.
I would just add one thing to that, and that is that everyone can do this. Anyone can do this. Mm-hmm. It's the way we're built.
We're born to do it.
We have everything inside to do this. We have, you know, all the energetics, everything. It's just a matter of stopping from out here and going in here for just a little bit of time, clean house, and then out here is so much more better.
Yeah.
More better.
This has been such a beautiful conversation, guys. It was wonderful. And I really hope that this is the rock that has dropped in the pond and starts to ripple away for many people listening. So I appreciate you, and I appreciate all the work you're doing to help awaken and help the world. So thank you for this so much, guys. Thank you.
Right back at you, Alex. Yeah. We hope to do this again with you, man. It was really great.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey. And don't forget to subscribe.